Hello everyone, and recently I've been getting more and more requests to do comparison videos, which coincides with me quietly testing a lot of new lenses in my secret laboratory, including on a new Nikon camera. So here's a group test of 6 similar macro lenses from 6 different manufacturers, all in the 100mm f2.8 range, or thereabouts. I thought it would be really interesting to see what each manufacturer can do. Before I compare these 6 lenses nice and closely, let's give them each a very brief, simple introduction in alphabetical order. By the way, if you'd like more information about any of these lenses, then pop over onto my YouTube channel where you can find full reviews of, well, nearly all of them, the Nikon lens and the Sigma lens. Those reviews are coming soon. Firstly, the Canon EF 100mm f2.8 Macro IS USM L. This lens's quality blew everyone away when it was released, but that was over 10 years ago now. It's nicely weather sealed and has an image stabilization system that was quite sophisticated for its time. It's for Canon digital SLR cameras, but it can be adapted onto mirrorless camera systems quite easily, and it costs about $900 or £700 in the UK, so it's an expensive option. Next, the Venus Optics Lauer 100mm f2.8 2x macro. This lens is unique to the others in that it's manual focus only, but it can focus twice as close to your subject than any other macro lens on this list, and that's a great feature. It will squeeze out a lot more detail from your small subject without the need for any extension tubes or anything. It's available on a large number of camera systems, Canon EF and RF, Nikon F and Z mount, and Sony E mount, and it costs only $450 or £450 here in the UK. Next, the Nikon AFS VR Micro Nikkor 105mm f2.8 GIFED lens. What a mouthful! It's the oldest lens in this group, first coming out in 2006, long before the time of very high resolution digital cameras. It features Nikon's second generation image stabilization system, which works a lot better than you might think. It's actually quite a fun lens to use. It's for Nikon's digital SLR cameras, but it can easily be adapted onto their new Z mount mirrorless camera system too. It costs $900 or £750 in the UK, but as it's quite an old lens now, you can get it far, far cheaper second hand if you want to. Now we come to the Sigma 105mm f2.8 EX-DG OS-HSM Macro. It's another slightly older lens now, coming out in 2011, but it has a good reputation for sharpness, and considering it has image stabilization, it's pretty amazing value for money, at only $500 in the US, and at the moment, only £300 in the UK. Its build quality is a bit plasticky, but it works very nicely and has a lot of happy owners. As far as I can tell, it's currently only available for Canon and Nikon digital SLR cameras, but it can easily be adapted onto mirrorless camera systems. Next, the Sony FE90mm f2.8 Macro GOSS. It's just about the newest and most expensive lens in this group, but you get a lens which has an absolutely stellar reputation on the internet for your money. In my tests, I found it to be incredibly sharp, and it has very solid, metallic build quality with a neat, adjustable, manual focus ring. It's a bit of a star lens, but it's only for Sony's mirrorless E-mount systems, and costs $1,100 or about £850 in the UK. And finally, we have a mid-range option, the Tamron 90mm f2.8 VC USD Macro lens. This is the newest version, also known as the F017 version, which has lovely metallic build quality. It's another newer lens with nice handling and specifications, decent optics, and a reasonable price of $650 or £650 here in the UK. It's for Canon, Nikon, and Sony digital SLR cameras, but it can also be adapted easily onto mirrorless camera systems. So, that's a little introduction to our 6 lenses. Let's start properly by looking at build quality and functionality. Now, 5 out of these 6 lenses have autofocus and image stabilization, which obviously gets them bonus points. Their image stabilization systems work broadly very similarly, quite efficient, although they're nowhere near as effective when shooting at very close distances, I'm afraid. All five have internal focusing and quiet, ultrasonic autofocus motors, so they're all really modern lenses in that respect. The Venus Optics Lauer lens stands out as it's manual focus only and lacks image stabilization, although it is worth bearing in mind that many cameras now have in-body image stabilization to make up for that. The toughest feeling lenses are those which are made of metal, the Tamron, Lauer, Nikon and Sony lenses, and the Sony lens has a particularly cool adjustable focus ring. The Canon lens is made of high quality plastics, but is very well weather sealed to make up for that somewhat. Due to it being manual focus only, the Lauer lens might seem like the weakest link here, but it comes out swinging with an excellent special feature. It can focus twice as closely as the other five lenses, down to 2:1 magnification. When I was testing the lens, I always found that to be incredibly fun. You can get just so close to your subject. You need to be shooting in plenty of light though to do so easily, or you do need to use a tripod. Still, those 2:1 magnification images are really dramatic, and the more serious macro photographers among you might be really interested in that. Overall, all six lenses are very well made really, and the five electronic ones all function similarly well. As I mentioned, the Lauer lens stands out for being manual focus only, but it has that awesome extra close focusing special feature for serious macro shooters. Alright then, let's move on and take a look at these lenses' sharpness at normal focus distances. They were all tested on a 42 megapixel Sony a7R II camera, except for the Nikon lens, which is at the slightest of disadvantages here, as I tested it on a 45 megapixel Nikon Z7, but I'll only zoom in to the same magnification as the other five lenses here, to keep it fair. At f2.8, in the middle of the image, the Sony and Lauer lenses are easily the sharpest. The Canon and Sigma lenses are close behind, and the Tamron lens is just slightly behind them. The weakest is the Nikon lens, which suffers from some low contrast and a little colour fringing. Let's look over in the corners. Well, there are two clear winners here. The Sony and Lauer lenses are the sharpest, with the punchiest contrast, and the Lauer lens actually seems to have a slight edge over the Sony. The softest is the Sigma lens, with a Canon, Nikon and Tamron floating around in the middle. If we stop those lenses down to f4, we can see some improvements, although the overall pecking order remains the same, more or less. If we stop down at apertures as far as f8, then the softer lenses really start to catch up nicely with the Sony and Lauer options, with the Tamron and Sigma lenses showing particularly noticeable improvements. If we stop down the apertures to f16, we can see that even the sharpest lenses begin to get a little softer due to the physical effects of diffraction. So overall, at normal distances, the sharpest lens has to be the Venus Optics Lauer, very closely followed by the Sony. That's all well and good, but how about if we get really close to our subject, down to 1:1 magnification? I tested out the Tamron lens a little while ago on a slightly different coin, apologies for that. At f2.8, most of the lenses look fantastic right off the bat. The Sigma and the Lauer lenses have particularly impressive contrast, although the Sigma lens shows a little purple fringing. The older Nikon lens surprised me by being a bit of a disaster here though. I definitely focused it properly, the contrast has just bottomed out. If you stop the lenses down to f4, then the only major differences is that the purple fringing on the Sigma lens is gone, and the Nikon shows just a tiny improvement. It's only really at f8 that the Nikon lens starts to play in the same league as the others. It was a properly working copy of the lens, I promise. Anyway, at close focal distances, diffraction starts to soften your image at brighter apertures, so it's about at f11 that we begin to see image quality softening here, and all six lenses perform similarly now. You don't really want to stop down much further than that on a very high resolution camera. Well, that would be it, but just for your interest, if you focus down to the full 2:1 magnification of the Lauer lens, its image looks like this. As you can see, it's quite a bit closer, and still, thankfully, extremely sharp straight from f2.8. but because we're working so closely now, diffraction begins to soften your image at only f8, so you won't really want to stop down to f11 or darker. That's just the laws of physics for you though, you can't avoid diffraction. Anyway, let's move on from sharpness and look at distortion and vignetting. All six lenses have about the same level of vignetting here, really. Their corners look a bit dark at f2.8, but from f4 they're much, much brighter. There are only minor variances in distortion levels. Most of them show a pretty negligible level of barrel distortion, the Lauer lens a little pincushion distortion, nothing seriously bad for any of them, really. Now let's see how each of these lenses work against bright light. I've slowed the footage down here so it's a little easier to keep track of. The Nikon, Lauer and Sigma lenses all look a bit weak here. The Tamron is a little better than average, and the Canon and Sony lenses clearly have superior coatings as they perform really well, showing less flaring and higher contrast. Let's move on and look at bokeh. All six lenses can give you nicely out of focus backgrounds, and I'm pleased to say that, honestly, all six lenses render those backgrounds nice and softly. There is simply no one lens that stands out for being weaker or stronger in this regard, they all have lovely smooth bokeh. But how about when we're shooting close up? How do the lenses cope with longitudinal chromatic aberration, which is colourful highlighting before and after the plane of focus, which can really intrude on your macro images? Let's take a look. The Sony and Tamron lenses I only tested at f2.8 and with a different test subject, again, apologies for that. Despite being first party options, at f2.8, the Nikon and Canon lenses seem to show the strongest colour fringing here, with very noticeable green and pink highlighting. The Sigma, Sony and Tamron lenses all show a little bit less. A big round of applause goes to the Lauer lens for literally showing none at all. That is a huge achievement, which will really improve the quality of this lens's close-up images. If we stop the lenses down to f5.6, then the Sigma lens sees those colours mostly cleared up, and I imagine they're probably gone on the Tamron and Sony lenses too, but unfortunately I can't say for sure. So then, overall, here's a quick note on how I've scored the Venus Optics Lauer lens. I should penalise it for not having autofocus or image stabilisation, but I'm going to let that cool 2:1 magnification feature cancel that out in terms of points awarded. That seems fair to me. The worst performing lens was the Nikon 105mm, although perhaps that's not surprising, as it's by far the oldest, so it just wasn't designed with very high resolution digital cameras in mind. One of the best value lenses here is the Sigma 105mm lens. It's not the sharpest, but it's good, and costs a very low price considering that it's image stabilised. Beginner photographers who just want a lens that's inexpensive and easy to use might want to think about that one. The lens right in the middle of everything, with a decent performance across the board, is the Tamron lens. The best quality overall is the Sony 90mm, it really is a spectacular performer, but it's also by far the most expensive. But by far the most interesting lens on the list is easily the Lauer lens, I think. Serious macro photographers will pretty much only use manual focus anyway, and they're interested in getting the sharpest image quality and low longitudinal chromatic aberration, and the Lauer easily fulfills those requirements. So anyone who's particularly serious about macro photography should definitely check out the Lauer lens. But beginner photographers will probably prefer something with autofocus, as well as other people who will mostly shoot at normal distances. Well, I hope you've found this video helpful/interesting. It certainly took a long time for me to put together. Have fun making up your own minds which macro lens to go for, and God bless you in your photographic journeys.